The undisputed ruler of this territory is the dominant male leopard, Buddha, a 5-year-old sturdy individual in the prime of his life. Moving in and out of Buddha's domain is one of his females. She specializes in climbing the tall ebony and kigelia trees of Murami. She is called Mosweo, the Pale One. Tipa, their 3-year-old son, walks a dangerous line within his parents' territory. According to leopard lore, he should have moved on by now to fend for himself, but he's still around. Lingering between Buddha and Mosweo can only lead to trouble. He seems blissfully unaware of his predicament. But it is Mosweo's life that has undergone a dramatic change recently. She has just given birth to 2 cubs, and Tipa poses a potential threat to them. Her litter emerges from her carefully concealed den. She has fared well so far. Her 2 cubs were born in a bountiful summer. Leopards are solitary creatures, and as a mother, Mosweo relies on all her skills to raise her cubs. In general, leopard cub survival rate is below 50%. The majority of losses happen during the cub's first year of life, while the leopard mother leaves to hunt. It's a harsh reality that leopards have to contend with every time they give birth. Mosweo has no choice but to leave her cubs to find food. From her last litter, Tipa is the only survivor. He's an adolescent. He still lingers near the den site, familiar with his birthplace, frequenting the paths of his youth. Up to now, Mosweo has tolerated his presence in her territory. But the time has come for him to move on. Mosweo is on the warpath. She walks with purpose, her tail held high. The time has come for her to sever the bonds between them forever. Mosweo marks her territory near his tree. The hostility towards her son is plain to see. Their relationship has degenerated into open conflict. Tipa still bears the wounds from an earlier clash. Even though he is now bigger than his mother, as her son, Tipa remains relatively submissive. Reluctantly, he leaves the area. But unwisely, he'll continue to linger on the edge of his mother's territory. As he moves into a neighboring woodland, he stumbles on a mortal enemy. The lion scent carries, and he's alerted. He needs to be careful. His first few days in unfamiliar territory are dangerous, and he's extremely vulnerable. Lions are the leopard's biggest threat. Not only would they kill cubs, but they'd tear Tipa limb from limb. He has to skirt around them silently. With the threat to her cubs dealt with, Mosweo can now concentrate on the one thing she does best, hunting. She's an excellent climber. She likes a good vantage point, 7 or 8 meters above the ground. The leopard is the only big cat that uses gravity to hunt. Mosweo is an expert at it. This technique is quick, quiet, and efficient. But the impala alarm calls are a dead giveaway that a predator is operating in the forest. The hyenas have heard the commotion. She needs to hide the kill before they see her. They hunt in packs. They're strong and aggressive. Worse, hyenas kill leopard cubs. She cannot let them find her den. Risky move, she fetches the cubs and leads them back to feed, using the secret pathways she knows so well. With such small cubs, she cannot move the carcass into the safety of a tree, since they cannot climb. Down on the ground, they are all exposed to danger. Staying well hidden is their only option. This is the realm of the leopard. Camouflaged in the broken and dappled scrub, they can feed, undisturbed, for a while. Hyenas can smell the kill. Their circle around the scent tightens. Mosweo has to act quickly and decisively. She has a plan. Get the hyenas to focus on her and draw them far away enough for the cubs to leave the kill. Leopards constantly walk a fine line between safety and danger. As solitary cats, they have struck a perfect balance. But for a mother, this balance can mean sacrifice. Let the hyenas have their prize. Dead Tree Island changes radically with the seasons. It's one of the few places with permanent drinking water. But in summer, its herbivores rely on the rains for good grazing. The effects of these storms are felt across the Okavango and beyond. The result is a welcome flourish of green. Fresh leaves, grasses and shoots sprout, and animals leave the forest and spread out into the surrounding floodplains. This abundance of water and food brings on the birthing season for impala, one of the leopard's favorite prey. It happens during a time guaranteed to supply the best in nourishment and protection, minimizing the stress on the young, their mothers, and the herd. But the newborn impalas are highly vulnerable and face a variety of threats. The African rock python is another of Dead Tree Island's expert hunters. Muscular coils squeeze the life from its prey, asphyxiating it. It swallows the calf whole by extending its jaws using specialized hinges. The wandering impala herds provide a reliable source of food. Bosweo has killed one during the night and has hidden the fresh carcass in a thicket where she feeds quickly. To make this kill, she's had to leave her young alone and vulnerable. Now, she needs to get back to the den. As Mosweo approaches the den, she senses danger. Hyenas have been busy nearby. Her gentle calls are low and don't carry far, meant only for the ears of her cubs. Only one responds. The nightmare of all mothers now falls on Mosweo. Her calls seem desperate and at the same time hopeful. Her own flesh and blood has been taken from her in just one night. She has no option but to move on. In a leopard's life, there is no time to mourn the dead. The cub is growing, and it needs meat in its diet. The well-being of this lone cub now hinges on Mosweo's intimate knowledge of this area of the Okavango. The rains have stopped, and all around Dead Tree Island, the vegetation is beginning to brown. The animals sense this. Seasons determine behavioral patterns, and each species responds differently. Kudu males choose a suitable female, courting her with gallant displays. Tipa lurks in the undergrowth. He's strayed back into his original territory. The kudu are distracted and oblivious to any threat. But Tipa's lack of experience is plain to see. Perhaps he's still too young to realize he shouldn't expend energy on the unattainable. Prey the size of a kudu is out of his league. Flocks of quillias announce the onset of winter, the dry season. Many animals gravitate to the Dead Tree Island area for the permanent water. This harsher season allows for at least one miracle. The Kigalia tree blossoms to life. It offers a precious winter treasure. Flowers filled with nectar. Baboons drink from the crimson chalice. Tipa needs to be more flexible in his hunting strategy. He has to learn to anticipate his potential prey's movements. Baboons are messy eaters, and soon the impala move closer to feed on the flowers that carpet the ground. He silently watches and waits. He needs the impala to come to him. But the marauding baboon troop has singled out his tree. He's not as powerful as Buddha. They will not tolerate Tipa's presence. If they catch him, they'll try to kill him. cannot risk a confrontation. An injury may cost him dearly. Mosweo watches from a safe distance, keeping track of the conflict. She follows Tipa's prey now. Quietly, she begins her own hunt. She finds a tree ahead of the herd, hoping that the flowers will draw the impalas beneath her. Mosweo shows great patience. She watches the antelope's moves and identifies her target. This time, her signature high dive is off the mark. With her cover blown, the impalas keep a watch on her. Her annoyance is obvious. So much energy wasted for nothing. But she has to keep moving. She's out in the open, and the baboons are still in the area. But things only get worse. The impala alarms have alerted the lions. Mosweo is forced to play a game of cat and mouse to get back to her den without giving his position away. Tipa's reluctance to stay away from his mother's territory is causing chaos. His blundering kill attempts have multiplied the pressure on her. She is relieved to find her cub safe and well. She decides to move to a new den site. The lions were far too close for comfort. Her remaining cub, now 5 months old, is showing her character. She loves playing with her mother's tail. It's a good test of reflexes. Hidden in the dry grass, Mosweo rests, regaining her strength before she starts hunting again. For the moment, all is well with mother and cub. They're secure in the new den. Winter forces the elephants in from the surrounding desert. Lechwe gather here too. Water is their ally. In these last pools, they are safe from most predators. They're larger than impalas, but a big cat like Buddha should be able to pull them down. The Lechwe turn and watch their attacker. They take in his smell, burning it into their brains for future reference, making sure Buddha leaves the area. Within this changing season, Mosweo needs to move greater distances, passing the open floodplains to find the cover that she needs to hunt. She's following the movements of her prey, but so are the other predators. Relocation for a leopard is always risky, but she soon finds a tree in an area that she likes. From this vantage point, she can see the breeding herds of elephants steadily moving into the delta. It's October now, and the heat is intense. The floods that brought life to the region have almost all evaporated now. Dead Tree Island draws the inhabitants of the Okavango closer to the last remaining water. The last flooded pans now hold the fate of all these characters. They're drawn together in one group, and the paths of the predators cross dangerously close. Mosweo's cub is now at an age where she begins to explore further. It's high time she learned how to climb. A little unsure of herself, she attempts to reach some babblers. She's small and still vulnerable, even more so now that she's curious and able to venture out of hiding, especially when her mother's not around. Mosweo is far off, hunting. She doesn't often come to this part of the island, and she leaves her mark to enforce her presence. She moves onto an open plain, where two side-striped jackal are foraging. In this season of hardship, Mosweo takes advantage of any opportunity that presents itself. Although not normally a prey item, the jackals quickly become a target. But the side-striped jackal is no fool, and has an impressive turn of speed. Irritated with her failure, she leaves her mark and moves on. The jackal's barks are echoed by vervet monkeys chattering in the distance. These alarm calls alert Mosweo. They are coming from the direction of the den. Mosweo treads lightly as she moves closer to the place pinpointed by the monkeys. She starts searching, but what she finds is shocking. Her cub has its back leg caught in a tree, and its pelvis has been broken. Nothing she tries can help her last remaining cub. No gentle nudge. No affectionate encouragement. Perhaps an invitation to a last game. Her voice is almost pleading. A last attempt, and the cub's leg is freed. There is no more that Mazueo can do. With all her remaining strength, the cub pulls herself to her final resting place. But her mother has already decided to leave this traumatic scene behind. Mazueo seems to try to rub away her sense of loss. Is this the way a leopard mourns? The heat builds. The rains are coming. Buddha treads on new ground. He is following an interesting scent. One that he cannot help but find irresistible. It comes from this leopard. A new female has entered his territory. She is larger and stronger than Mazueo, and she brings the promise of fresh genes to Dead Tree Island. On the fringes, Mazueo watches with alarm. Buddha's senses trigger an uncontrollable need to cloak himself in the new female scent. Hers is not any smell. It is the perfume of a female in estrus. Mazueo follows his footsteps. His calls are low and clear, but she knows he's not calling her. What she smells is not appealing. The scent of another female, a rival. Instinctively, Mazueo tries to mask any hint of her challenger's presence, but she's too late. Buddha is already responding, laying a path of enticement. The new female is quick to take up his invitation. Mazueo retreats. Her efforts are futile. The rival has found her prize. She makes contact with Buddha. Mosweo leaves the place where she gave birth, perhaps to seek out another territory and a new partner. The dry winter finally breaks. And the change in season coaxes Buddha to mate. A new era begins for the leopards of Dead Tree Island. They mate for days, and by the end of it, the new female will hold the seed of new cubs. And so, tragedy gives way to hope, and the way of the wild shows its warmer side. Buddha is content that his job is done, and with the onset of another fruitful season, the legacy of Dead Tree Island's leopards is secure. From her last litter, Tipa is the only survivor. He's an adolescent. He still lingers near the den site, familiar with his birthplace, frequenting the paths of his youth. Up to now, Mosweo has tolerated his presence in her territory. But the time has come for him to move on. Mosweo is on the warpath. She walks with purpose, her tail held high. The time has come for her to sever the bonds between them forever. Mosweo marks her territory near his tree. The hostility towards her, limb from limb. He has to skirt around them silently. With the threat to her cubs dealt with, Mosweo can now concentrate on the one thing she does best, hunting. She's an excellent climber. She likes a good vantage point, 7 or 8 meters above the ground. The leopard is the only big cat that uses gravity to hunt. Mosweo is an expert at it. This technique is quick, quiet, and efficient. But it is Mosweo's life that has undergone a dramatic change recently. She has just given birth to 2 cubs. And Tipa poses a potential threat to them. Her litter emerges from her carefully concealed den. She has fared well so far. Her two cubs were born in a bountiful summer. Leopards are solitary creatures, and as a mother, Mosweya relies on all her skills to raise her cubs. In general, leopard cub survival rate is below 50%. The majority of losses happen during the cub's first year of life, while the leopard mother leaves to hunt. It's a harsh reality that leopards have to contend with every time they give birth. Mosweya has no choice but to leave her cubs to find food. Son is plain to see. Their relationship has degenerated into open conflict. Tipa still bears the wounds from an earlier clash. Even though he is now bigger than his mother, as her son, Tipa remains relatively submissive. Reluctantly, he leaves the area. But unwisely, he'll continue to linger on the edge of his mother's territory. As he moves into a neighboring woodland, he stumbles on a mortal enemy. The lion scent carries, and he's alerted. He needs to be careful. His first few days in unfamiliar territory are dangerous, and he's extremely vulnerable. Lions are the leopard's biggest threat. Not only would they kill cubs, but they'd tear Tipa. The undisputed ruler of this territory is the dominant male leopard, Buddha, a 5-year-old sturdy individual in the prime of his life. Moving in and out of Buddha's domain is one of his females. She specializes in climbing the tall ebony and kigalia trees of Murami. She is called Mosweya, the Pale One. Tipa, their 3-year-old son, walks a dangerous line within his parents' territory. According to leopard law, he should have moved on by now to fend for himself, but he's still around. Lingering between Buddha and Mosweya can only lead to trouble. He seems blissfully unaware of his predicament.